My name is Brett Stevens. I was a policeman up in King's Cross, the tactical response group, and also some at the drug squad back in the 80s and 90s in Australia. So the story of gangs is a multi-layered approach, and it starts all the way from cartels and the drug cartels who are established in various locations throughout the world with a product, and that is, you know, cocaine, a whole range of different drugs. How do they get that to market? That's when outlaw motorcycle gangs and those middle tier level gangs come in to play. They're able to secure a territory, because we all are territories. Where we live is owned by someone. They sit over that and they dominate it. They make money out of it. But how do they actually get everything to market from there? Well, that's where the street level gangs come in, all the way down to even use of children in those gangs to get their product to market. Drugs is one part of it. Extortion is another part of it. So you have to pay a tax to operate in their area. And from there also is theft, and stealing is also part of that. Again, where kids are coming into that picture as well. So the people who tend to be attracted to gangs, it's an actual societal issue. So in countries where you don't have a disparity between wealth and income, pretty much you don't really have that many gangs, okay? And there's no real desire to join gangs. And the West was much like that, but we've changed over the last 40 or 50 years. And what has occurred, we've had large numbers of young men come in from often very violent combat civil war societies. And those men come in and they go, well, okay, there's no pathway for me to become, have status and wealth. And status and wealth also attracts the opposite sex and mates. So what can they do that's different? Well, the gang offers them an opportunity for wealth, but also status and power. So it's an inverted pyramid. So when you go to the ghettos of the world and a lot of the poor areas of the world, it's inverted to the base, whereas the most violent and aggressive can attain status, and they attract women, but they also attract lots of young men to their banner who want to be like that. So everyone has to work for their set that's producing money. At that level, you're looking at lookouts. So if I've got a drug house, or if I'm just slinging dope on the side of the street, maybe cars drive up, I need people at either end of the street. I need to make sure no one's sneaking up on me. Also, I'm going to use those guys to hold my weapons. Also, I use women. So I'm ready to sacrifice the kids and also women, because also they're less likely to get a heavier sentence. Most of these guys, by the time they're 15 and 16, they've got a bit of a rap sheet. Okay, so if they get arrested again, they're looking at maybe, you know, months inside at that stage of their career, right? So easier to use like 11-year-olds and 13-year-olds because they're probably just going to slap on the wrist. Even if they're holding a gun, maybe they'll go inside, but there's no way are they going to go inside as long as someone who's done a lot more crime, right? So all the eyes are on you by this stage, you know, of your career. The cops know you, they're patrolling, they're going to frisk you. So stop and frisk is a thing. It keeps the crooks on their toes and less likely to be walking around with a gat to shoot an enemy. So usually what happens is, just say you've got the hardcore gangster walking down the road, the kids will be shadowing them, or the women will be shadowing them. But they're the ones holding the weapons. But the cops always zero in on the guy first, and they'll all slink away. Every area is owned by someone. I used to work at King's Cross. Why was there so much death and chaos and violence? It's because that could make you a lot of money if you owned that territory, right? Whereas other territories, not that much. So there's not much of a fight over it, okay? But everyone owns it. And that's why if you look at back at the Cronulla riots and that type of stuff, what was going on there was you had gangs from one area coming in and causing chaos and intimidation and stealing and everything else that was going on and running drugs, but there was no other gang to control it. And then the rebels came in, and I was sitting there the day they rode in, and I never saw another gangster, because now that was the rebels saying, this is our territory, you don't come in. It wasn't the police who kept them out, it was another gang. And it was the same with Maroubra. you had the Comancheros come in, even though you had a street gang down there, and they did fight the other gang. And that's what you see. And I saw the same thing in Huntington Beach. They couldn't keep the Crips from coming into Huntington Beach. And next thing, the skinheads were walking the street openly, and the police saw them, did nothing about it, didn't turn them over. Why? Because everyone had surrendered themselves to the gang to provide security, when law enforcement can no longer do that. If the Americans and Australians want drugs, and then we basically defeat the capability of the cartels to supply that because of no cash, so how do you buy it? And also, the tracking of gang members, so there's no real capability of your access to market anymore. If you destroy that, but the populace still wants their drugs, well then it could be legalization of drugs. I know they're already starting to talk about this in certain areas. Colombia's starting to talk about the legalization of cocaine. Mexico's starting to talk about the legalization of marijuana, and these will flow. And I look at these as soft drugs. Some drugs you probably wouldn't want to legalize, but if people have an alternative legal that's clean, most people probably would go that way. And then you just have a lot smaller element. In other words, the cartels would go legal. They're already starting to do that. They've got money. They're already starting to have logistics companies and other companies, the ways to make money, because a gang still needs to make money to support itself at the end of the day. So even though the legalization of drugs would impact the cartels and reduce that, we'll still end up with gangs. We'll still have extortion, we'll still have stealing and other things. They'll still play the game, but there won't be the whole culture of it.